What's up, Cardboard Nation? Welcome to another episode of Go GTS Live, the Hobbies web show. I'm your host, Rob Bertrand. Joining me, as always, Ivan Lovgren. Ivan, how you doing, brother?
Rob, it's been a day. I think we'll get into that in a little. It's been a week for all of us. It's been a month for our country, right? So that said, we've got some fun stuff today. So maybe let's kick off with letting them know what's going on, and then get into the poll and have our discussion. Yeah. So,
well, this is let's see, season 5, episode 20, master episode 171. So we're just racking them up. And we've got already a great poll question we'll circle back to. Hobby happenings, a surprise giveaway related to hobby happenings.
Ooh,
I was expecting two shipments of new product releases for this week that did not come. But fortunately, I have three other boxes that because I was thinking I was going to have new product, that are already opened, so we'll show the highlights and the hits from those three boxes.
Cool. And still give away the hits, right?
Oh, yeah. Ooh, of course. Nice. Okay. I had the opportunity to talk with WWE superstar Mickie James this week in a lengthy 40-minute interview. We'll show the first part of that. And a lot of products hitting store shelves for Hot in the Shop next week. And then we'll take and show you the PC of a Australian collector.
Ooh.
And that's pretty cool. But to circle back and talk about the Go GTS Live Q of the Week poll, a lot of engagement with this already prior to us going live. Have you or do you plan to purchase any Topps Project 2020 cards? And your choice is very simple, yes or no. Pretty close so far, but yes is weighing out 56.7% over 43.3% saying no. Ivan, I know you're obviously yes.
Oh, yeah. I'm showing some off right now because, of course, they're littered around my desk as I'm trying to.
I know. And I voted no. It's just not my cup of tea. So, but that's what's great about this hobby. There's something for everybody.
So, Rob, I am curious a little bit because you voted no, but we're only 100 cards in, maybe 102 cards as of today. Do you plan to? Are you open to being surprised if you see something you like?
I mean, of course, but
So I only bring it up because the thing that has been so intriguing to me about Project 2020 so far, and I've been running, you know, semi-similar polls, but more of a when did you buy your first? And it seems like every week I get anywhere from 20 to 40 new people that say, oh, I finally bought my first card this week, even some people that hated it before. So that's the one thing that I've loved about the project as a whole, is that you don't have to love each card for the possibility that you could end up getting something from it. So, well, just thinking out loud here a little bit.
Well, here's the thing. My fear at this point is that if I bought a Cal Ripken or a Nolan Ryan card, which are two players that I PC, which are part of this project, that at that point, because of the completist in me, I would feel then obligated to like go and get all the past releases, and I don't want to go down that road. So that's why I'm pretty confident saying no, because I would rather take that cumulative money that I would spend undoubtedly trying to complete those two PC collections and spending them on individual cards that I couldn't otherwise afford had I not said, okay, I'm going to commit to this. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I can respect that, especially because, you know, it kind of leads into our conversation that we were having before the show and why I'm a little bit more subdued today. I'm having a little trouble getting the normal enthusiasm that I have for collecting, for the show, for all my friends up, just because of some other stuff that's going on.
Well, Dr. Rob is here. He's here for you, so... Let's, you know, take a seat on the couch.
I am. I don't know that we if we mentioned or not, but make sure you do go to twitter.com/goGTSLive to vote in that poll, as well as retweet our pinned Periscope broadcast to enter in some of the giveaways we're going to do. So go vote in the poll and share your opinion. And if you want to enhance it with what I've got going on, feel free. We love dialogue on the GoGTS Live Twitter. But yeah, so Rob, I love that you say that you kind of know that if you dove in too slightly, it would turn into too deeply at this point. Because I've just sort of been dealing with that. You know, I've been heavier in the Project 2020, and it's been well documented how people are requesting returns now that the market has done this and this and this and this, you know, and prices of cards and eBay. And that's not what has me down so much. You know, I can deal with all that. But I've just seen today, completely off of Twitter, in fact, I love all of my hobby brothers and sisters on Twitter. I love the engagement. I haven't even been on very much today. But I've had some things on the back end that have really highlighted for me how much of an addiction collecting can be, whether that's packs, whether that's buying all the Project 2020 you can because you think they're going to go up, and then having to send sellers very honest messages talking about where your family is at. And I say that specifically because I got one of those, and it wasn't a scam, I know, because the person gave me all these cards look good. So I could use that in an eBay case. They're not opening an eBay case. They're asking my better decency as a human. And it's, I don't know, I just think that we don't talk about it quite enough as a hobby. You know, there's so many people that make money pumping the hobby, myself included. You know, yourself included. But I know that you do it with a great heart for friends and people and those you know and love in the hobby. And we come to it from a passion for collecting, but it's very scary. You know, and I ripped 20 value packs of Bowman myself yesterday that I got from Walmart on pre-order, you know, not even the big stuff. And I know how when you open 7 packs and you got 13 more, it's like the temptation is there. So I don't know. I just feel like we don't talk about it quite enough, and I feel like it does cause people to overreach.
Well,
you know,
I mean, I
don't know. Just streaming.
No. And not to necessarily interrupt you, but to add another point of conversation to this dialogue. This is a hobby, okay? Your hobby is supposed to be something that you enjoy. And if your hobby is causing financial stress to either yourself or your family members and loved ones, guess what? It is no longer a hobby. It is a flat-out addiction, no different than gambling or other things. And that's the problem. And so a lot of times, sellers like yourself get put in a situation where to be preyed on your good human nature. But in all honesty, Ivan, I think to refund any money to this individual, aren't you just enabling them? Aren't you just giving them, you know, feeding an out for the next time when they do that, as comparison to maybe learning a hard lesson this time?
Well, I mean, that's almost a completely different debate. I'm more concerned about the general hobbyist that's out there and maybe is rushing in a little too far, a little too fast.
Okay.
You know, what they're going through. Whether I should help this person out or not, I don't know. I haven't even had time to wrestle with that yet. But, you know, I think that as a larger warning, you know, that's honestly, I use one example, but I've had 4 today.
Ugh.
Off Twitter, like examples of this in my life pop up. And so, you know, and then comparing it against my own habits and saying, am I overreaching? Am I doing too much? Am I, you know, doing this? So I don't know. That's just sort of where I'm at space wise. And, you know, it is compounded by, let's be honest, a hobby box of Bowman being $260 for one autograph. You know, a National Treasure hobby box, you know, that we saw on Dutch auction today at $9,000. And last year, we thought $4,000 was high.
Well, it because the Dutch auction feature eliminated the quantity sold at, we aren't able to metrically track that pricing like we used to be. But I mean, I believe, now I could be wrong, but I think this is one of the only instances with National Treasure First Off the Line that it sold out at its floor price, right?
That's what I've been hearing. As I mentioned, I actually wasn't on Twitter as much today. And I also, flipping that, I was not upset. I saw a lot of tweets saying, $30,000, what is Panini thinking? Well, we all, that's how a Dutch auction works. You started an unreasonable number and work your way down. So I'm not even upset about that, but I'm just thinking out loud that, you know, there's an interesting middle ground. There's some big, big money pockets in the hobby. You know, we've seen billionaires sell their companies and start collecting, and that's fine. But if you're somewhere in the middle, don't feel the FOMO, the fear of missing out, to overreach what's actually healthy, you know. And don't count on 3-week turnaround flips either to be able to fund overreaching. You know, there's a balance to be had.
I think that's a great point, because you and I had a conversation after the show a few weeks ago where I was kind of feeling like, man, you know, my family sure could have benefited from some foresight on my part and got in on this quote game. But in all honesty, listening to some of the crap you're dealing with, I'm really glad I never did, because I mean, I don't want to put that emotional energy into something like that, you know? And so I feel for you, brother. And so I think it's good though that you're now questioning, have you maybe overreached in the process without, you know, realizing it. It's just, it's something that everybody really needs to be aware of, because it's a hobby. And when it stops being fun in any respect, you really got to question, what are you doing? You know, and there's lots of ways to enjoy this hobby. You don't have to ever buy a pack of new cards, and you're still part of the hobby if you're a vintage collector, or, you know, and so.
Well, and Rob, I would even add on to that, because obviously, you know, GTS distribution, like, yeah, we want to sell cards, but there is a point where keeping the buying base healthy keeps the hobby going.
Yeah,
you know, there's been a lot of growth in the hobby lately, you know, in the last 2-3 years that I think is really positive. I still love Project 2020 for the reasons we talked about during the poll. But let's keep it healthy so that we can continue instead of hitting a point where we explode ourselves, you know?
I highly encourage you guys to read Klein's Corner. Hobby veteran Richard Klein writes a blog post for us on GoGTS.net. And he asked the question, is new money better than old money? And he made some really astute observations. And, you know, while this new attention to the hobby is great, it's really only great if X percentage of them stay, you know, they're not just in and out for the quick flip, the hype, the fad of it or whatever. The sustainability, like you said, happens when we turn a percentage of those new entrants into dedicated hobbyists and collectors that are in for the long haul.
Yeah, and I would even agree with that, that that's been one of the reasons why I still have not taken the true collector standpoint of yelling at people trying to make some money in the hobby, because I do see constantly, oh, I got into it, you know, to make some money on this thing, and then I went out and bought a, you know, a box of Heritage and pulled a nickel with my favorite player, and that was the coolest thing ever. And, you know, it's like there's
that's
a balance to all things.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Well,
I'm going to go ahead and tweet that link out actually right now from the GoGTS Live site to the Klein's Corner article. So make sure again that you follow twitter.com/GoGTS Live. That's also where we're going to be running the giveaways. So you don't have to watch through Twitter necessarily, but you do have to be following us and engage there in order to be involved. And thanks, Rob. I felt like that was a really good conversation. It makes me feel a lot better just talking about it out loud, you know.
Well, this therapy stuff, it actually works. And I encourage anybody out there who, you know, in the back of their mind has that itch that says, you know what, I'm in too deep. Hey, talk to somebody about it. It's all right. I swear, we've all been there in some form, way or the other. Maybe not to the degree financially that you are, but talk to somebody about it, okay? Thanks for being willing to talk about that, Ivan.
Yeah, certainly.
All right, let's shift gears and talk about some other things going on in the hobby with some news, notes, and nuggets in this week's hobby happenings. Well, I'm really excited to announce that the latest publication from Tom Zappala Media is ready to pre-order ahead of its July release. Titled Baseball and Bubblegum, the book takes a detailed look at the famous 1952 Topps baseball card collection. Tom and his wife Ellen have collaborated, as you may or may not know, on several collectibles-related coffee table-sized books in recent years, including the T206 collection and one of my personal favorites, the Cracker Jack collection. Again, The book is available for pre-order and will also most likely be part of a future PSA membership offering, as other books have in the past.
Well, Rob, you have to be a pretty diehard vintage collector to know who this player is and why a practical joke led to his cardboard legacy far more than his journeyman career in Major League Baseball. Watch this and find out why.
He once filled an opening in the Astros bullpen, yet couldn't close his own pants. Was it by accident or done on purpose? It's another strange but true Houston sports story from Jason Bristol.
Many Astros baseball cards are worth big bucks. This is not one of them, though the story behind that photo is priceless. It's 1966, and inside some packages of Topps trading cards, card number 586, Claude Raymond, relief pitcher for the Houston Astros. And whoa, wait a minute, is his fly open?
What?
Yep, it's undone for the entire world to see. It's pretty remarkable that photo was used. What's even more remarkable, on Claude's card the following year, he's pictured again with his fly open. Not zipping his pants? By accident or by design? Claude, or Frenchie as he was known as a player, is now 83 years old and living in Quebec. He recently told me the truth.
It was kind of a joke, you know, because the photographer was a real friendly old man from New York. You know, some of us, you know, we try to make fun and stuff like that, but nothing vulgar.
Yep, it was all a joke. Claude Raymond posing for pictures with his pants unzipped? It's another strange but true Houston sports story.
Wow. Now, here's a super collector if we ever saw one. Meet Boston Red Sox bat collector Jeff Bajoukos. Sports Collectors Daily reports that since 1992, Bajoukos has been putting together a collection that includes a game-used bat of, check this out, each Red Sox non-pitcher who's had an at-bat for the Red Sox from 1960 to the present. Now, keep in mind, 1960 was the last year of Ted Williams' career, so he's got one of those. And 1961 would be the first year for Karl Yastrzemski, so he's got one of those. His collection actually recently earned him the recognition of the Baseball Reliquary, something that Ivan turned us on to a couple seasons ago, as the recipient of the 2020 Hilda Award. Established in 2001 in memory of Hilda Chester, the legendary Brooklyn Dodgers fan, the Hilda Award recognizes distinguished service to the game by a baseball fan. In talking about the collection, Bajuko said, "It was an undertaking that I frankly never thought I would complete, and as of today amounts to over 757 bats." With the advent of eBay and networking and help of a number of fantastic collectors, and with the support of even players, I've been able to collect a bat from every player except one. Ken Polson. So if anybody can help Jeff, let us know and we'll connect you guys. But hey, congrats on a job well done, Jeff. That's really cool.
That's fantastic. Yeah, and Ken Polson, if you're watching, contact us. We'll get you in touch with Jeff. Cryptozoic Con 2020 number 2 is coming next week, starting June 11th. The virtual event will once again feature several exclusives, promos, sneak peeks, giveaways, and panels. Outlander collectors will want to be sure to tune in each day, as 3 convention-exclusive wardrobe cards will be available for purchase starting at 12:55 p.m. Pacific time. Hope that there's not Outlander bots chasing after those. This oversized wardrobe costume card of series star Catriona Belfi, who plays Claire Frazier, is sure to be a huge hit. Collectors will also be able to gain insight into the production and development process with a Q&A session online with the Cryptozoic product development team. It all starts next week on June 11th.
Very cool. Interestingly enough, one hobby forum that has been somewhat dormant is now under new ownership. Sports Collectors Daily reports that longtime hobbyist Mike Matthews has recently acquired Sports Card Club and is hoping to turn it into a place where collectors can share their memorabilia and make transactions. Some of you might have known that Matthews used to operate one of the original hobby forums, Trading Card Zone, before running into personal health issues and taking it offline for a while. He's now merged that site with SCC, so be sure to check it out at sportscardclub.com.
This next story is fit for a TV show like Storage Wars and should just warm the hackles of every jaded collector's hearts. Sports Collectors Daily reports that a stash of previously unknown 1995 action-packed redemption autographs has recently been found in a storage locker.
What?
Yeah. What is that? 25 years? Longest redemption ever fulfilled? Definitely in the running. Tyler Feldman of Las Vegas found 2 boxes of autograph redemption cards from the 1995 action-packed Hall of Fame basketball set. So unfortunately, if you had action-packed football redemption cards, you're SOL. The boxes held a total of about 600 cards, including 93 signed by Basketball Hall of Famer Bill Russell, along with signed cards of fellow Hall of Famers Bill Bradley, Bob Cousy, and Bill Walton. There were 94 Bradley autographs and 96 each for Cousy and Walton. In addition, Feldman found multiple autographed cards of Dean Smith, Hal Greer, Connie Hawkins, Dolph Schayes, Nate Thurmond, Jerry Lucas, Walt Bellamy, Calvin Murphy, Frank Ramsey, wow, Carol Blazowski, sorry, and Nate Archibald. But as you can imagine, it was the Russell cards that were especially intriguing, because for the longest time, he refused to sign autographs at all, but apparently signed a deal with Action Packed in 1995. These cards were the first autographed trading cards that Bill Russell ever signed. His ones are the only ones in the set that are hand-numbered also, each to 100. In addition to all of those autographs, the find also included 360 24-karat gold versions of Bradley, Walton, Cousy, and Russell, which you'll remember Action Packed was famous for. It was about 90 of each of those 4 players that no one apparently knew existed. And what Action Packed planned to do with those 24-karat gold cards is still a mystery. Wow. Now, if you want your redemptions fulfilled, please there is no information for that. Congratulations, though, Tyler Feldman, and thank you, Sports Collectors Daily, for the wonderful story.
I knew you would appreciate that action-packed story. Well, as if the hype surrounding Topps Project 2020 wasn't enough already, this week, Topps announced that moving forward, every future card of Mike Trout will have 10 randomly signed copies distributed as part of the purchased print run. Trout's commitment to sign for the last 15 cards means that there'll be a total of 150 autographed Trout cards when the pot project comes to a close later this year.
As they say, the show must go on. And with that in mind, the Sports Card Expo has announced the first guest scheduled to appear at this year's virtual event. First is a live Q&A with Hall of Fame slugger Reggie Jackson. Wonder if he'll be signing autographs digitally. As well as a similar experience with Hockey Hall of Famer Phil Esposito. Tickets are still available for the two-day virtual event with both athlete and vendor access. That event is scheduled for June 19th and 20th.
And Sports Collectors Daily also reported this week that Heritage Auctions has moved its corporate headquarters in Dallas to a new single-story 160,000 square foot facility. It's longer than three football fields. Located less than 30 minutes from downtown Dallas, the new Heritage campus includes a large gallery space for events, expositions, exhibitions, and possibly even its own collectible shows. CEO Steve Ivey said, "This location and facility will better serve all of our clients, including bidders and consigners who visit our showrooms or consign with us."
Nice. Congratulations to my fellow neighbors. They also have an office down the street from me in Beverly Hills. A feel-good story from the National Bobblehead Hall of Fame and Museum was making the rounds this week. Watch this.
If you look around your office or home, chances are you'll see some of these. Whether they're a coworker's, a kid's, or yours, bobbleheads are everywhere. Giveaway days have become the most popular games for teams like the Brewers and Bucks, as sold-out crowds come early just to make sure they get their hands on one.
Bobbleheads are typically up here as people who have done, you know, great things or who are sports stars. And, you know, this period that we've been in, the heroes have been sort of everyday heroes.
So the Bobblehead Hall of Fame and Museum came up with a way to honor those essential heroes, making 35 custom bobbleheads.
Some of the other people who don't get a bobblehead day, you know, at the Brewers game or at a Bucks game, but, you know, now they have a bobblehead to honor them.
They're donating $5 from each sale of the essential heroes to the Protect the Heroes campaign, helping provide frontline workers with personal protective equipment.
We thought that was a great cause. It was one of the most critical needs. It is going directly to hospitals across the country, both locally and nationally, to help support them.
They've been sending a check to the Protect the Heroes campaign every week for 2 months now, ever since they unveiled their best-selling Dr. Anthony Fauci bobblehead. With thousands of orders, that money adds up quickly. The National Bobblehead Hall of Fame and Museum has already donated more than $225,000. Reporting from home, Scott Grodzki, CBS 58 Sports.
That's a very cool story. And I'd like to announce a surprise giveaway in conjunction with the story that we talked about with the Cryptozoic Con. Cryptozoic was kind enough to provide us promo cards that are exclusive to the con.
Ooh.
They will be given away at the con. This is P7, P8, and P9. And I've been told that I can give two sets away, but I cannot ship them until the 12th.
Nice.
So one of the things I wanted to do, kicking things off. Yeah, one of the things I wanted to do as that kind of wraps up a look at this week's hobby happenings, I wanted to announce our first winner tonight because I have the power to do that. This set, and don't worry, I have two, but this set is going to Go GTS Live's biggest Outlander fan, Melanie Pauls. So, Melanie, this will be coming to you, but I can't ship it until next Friday. So I would write that
down. Which is a little ironic because I
write down that I have another
one. Melanie is such a fan. I guarantee you that she is still going to participate in the Cryptozoic Con. And that's okay.
Oh, yeah.
Very happy. Melanie's a wonderful fan of the show, wonderful conversationalist, and huge Outlander fan. I've got a visitor back here. Sorry. It was made public a few weeks back that my children have figured out they broke the lock on my little office door. So now I'm at my wife's mercy for her to come and shut the door because the kid just left. But yeah, okay, so Melanie is going to win that. I am going to get a tweet put together with that picture I just snagged that you can go to twitter.com/goGTSLive and retweet to enter to win. If you want to be our second winner. Oh, I see Melanie on the Twitch there, or Periscope, saying hi. Oh my God. She was not expecting that. That's awesome. So that'll be up on Twitter. And we've got some more exciting box product previews to look at.
Absolutely. And we'll kick things off with highlights from a second box of 2020 Select Baseball. We took a look at this product last week, and I saw some of you posting the cards that you received from that break this week on Twitter. Thanks for tagging us. Always love to see that. And people seem to like them in hand, commenting that they look even better in person, and I couldn't agree more. All right. So let's
was that
see.
June 11th or June 11th is the con, right?
11th and the 12th, yes. All right. So we have a silver Whit Merrifield prism and a concourse level Jose Altuve. And some fun inserts, Select Stars, Clayton Kershaw, Zach Britton, 25th man, Sensations, Select Sensations, Juan Soto, Phenoms, J.J. Bleddy, Moonshots, I really like this one, that design, Alex Bregman, and another 25th man, Ronald Acuna Jr. Okay, super shiny. And let's see, then we have a bunch of different prisms here. Andres Munoz, Spencer Turnbull, 25th man Mookie Betts prism.
Oh, cool. Just a reminder, there's generally 9 parallels in every box, in addition to the 2 autographs and 2 memorabilia cards we're chasing.
I think these are still called tie-dye, right? Shane Bieber?
Oh, I could answer that, but the checklist is 98 pages long.
I know. So, Giancarlo Stanton.
If you want the answer, go to gogts.net and search for 2020 Panini Select baseball cards or basketball cards.
And then we did find some numbered parallels. This one's a red one of Sterling Marte, and it's numbered to 199. We found this one of Patrick Sandoval, numbered at just 50. And a green Marcus Simeon, numbered 299.
Well, that's a cool parallel with the Athletics colors there.
Yeah, really popped. We did pretty good on our hits. How about a jumbo Bobby Bradley Prism jumbo jersey swatch, numbered to 250. And then this one of, this is a jersey swatch auto of Chicago Cubs Adbert Alzolay. And this one's numbered to just 209. So we'll give both of those away to individual winners. Let's see. How about a jumbo oversized patch of Tony Gonsolin of the Los Angeles Dodgers? And this one is numbered to, oh geez, look at that. It's numbered to just 10. But by far, the biggest hit and the most beautiful card in the whole box, even though that one was numbered to just 10, was this Yu Chang patch auto numbered to 25.
Whoa, that's shiny, sparkly, chunky, everything I love in a trading card.
So four winners, the Yu Chang, the Tony Gonsolin, the Adbert Azalea, and the Bobby Bradley.
Got it. All right. I'm going to go throw that tweet up right now for people to retweet, twitter.com/GoGTSLive.
And Ivan, you did hear that there was a second set of promo cards we're going
to
give away.
Yeah, right? I put up a giveaway tweet for that exclusively as a thank you to Cryptozoic. Cool. And but now that I'm thinking about it, I don't know that I tagged Cryptozoic. I'm fired. I'm getting rusty in my old age.
You're all good. You're all
I tried good. To order Instacart from Instagram, and it wouldn't let me. I was so confused.
Next up, we have a second look at Sage High Series Hit Premier Draft football cards with 16 autograph cards in every box. First, a look at some inserts. We got the complete five-card Joe Burrow set, five-star, a season for the ages, high school star, next level talent, LSU debut season, trophy room, and a gold parallel LSU debut season, and an art gallery Joe Burrow card. So I'm going to give this to one person. Nice little set of Joe Burrow cards.
Oh, cool.
We also pulled an art gallery of DJ Dallas. Beautiful card. And speaking of DJ Dallas, we also pulled a peak performance card. So I'm going to give that to a second winner, those two DJ Dallas cards. We found some next level inserts. Some of the key players we found was Justin Jefferson, DeAndre Swift, Cam Akers, Jordan Love, CeeDee Lamb, and Tua. So, and all right, so some of the autos that we found. Tommy Stevens, quarterback at Mississippi State. Linebacker David Woodward. Wide receiver Isaiah Coulter. Linebacker Casa Malia. Outside linebacker Tyler Higbee. Quarterback for Wisconsin and Florida State, Alex Hornibrook. Davion Taylor. Another Casa Maluya, but this one's numbered to 200. Ray Wilborn. And a beautiful C.D. Lamb, numbered to 200. Other autographs we found. Isaiah Hodgins, numbered to just 50, peak performance auto. And we found four on cards, including next level Khalil Tate, Tay Crowder, Jerry Jeudy.
Ooh.
And
I felt it was building up to something.
Numbered to just 25, Lucy Jackson. So again, 16 autos. What I'm going to do, four winners will each receive four autograph cards randomly selected. In addition to those four winners, as mentioned, insert winners for DJ Dallas and Joe Burrow.
Awesome. So four winners for autographs, which are going to get one of the on card each,
yes,
as well as three other autos,
yes,
because those Sage boxes have 16 autographs. Kind of incredible. And we're going to give away those two special base card collections, not even base card, cards, inserts and whatnot.
Yep.
I love it. Very cool. Really been enjoying Sage this year.
Me too.
Stepped it up. I love it.
Absolutely. Okay. Our last highlights box break tonight is Panini Contenders draft picks, collegiate football cards for 2020. Six autograph cards in every box. I'll show you some of the fun stuff we pulled. Draft class 2020, Henry Ruggs III, subject of one of our Future Watch player profiles by Russ Cohen, which can be found on GoGTS.net. Excuse me. DeAndre Swift, draft class 2020, another Future Watch player profile, as is Tua Tagliavola, draft class 2020, Jonathan Taylor, and Jake Fromm. This card is pretty cool. Anytime you get a card numbered to 15, Mason Rudolph season ticket. That's pretty cool. And now our autographs. College ticket auto of Jordan Brooks. Jamaical Hasty. Tavion Feaster. Numbered to 99, bowl ticket auto of Cole McDonald. Quarterback from Hawaii. Huge stats. A playoff ticket auto numbered to just 18 of Antonio Gandy Golden.
Oh, nice. I forget where, but he was at least a top three-round draft pick.
And numbered to just 23, a school colors autograph of Zach Moss from the University of Utah. So what we're going to do we had three numbered, and everybody else is going to get another auto. So three random contenders winners are each going to get two autograph cards. And a fourth winner will receive the Mason Rudolph card number to 15 and all the 2020 draft class insert cards.
Cool. So four winners from that one box. I love it. You're inflating the giveaway numbers here, Rob. I was like, let's just give away the big numbered hit. You're like, no, we're gonna give it all away.
Yeah, I wanted to
get... Didn't have enough shipping to do last week, huh, with our 12 winners or whatnot. Like, we gotta up it.
Yeah, it was done too quickly. I was like, need to give away more stuff. So that's a wrap on our look at some highlights from some box breaks. And
what was the number on that? Number to 18?
Yes.
Antonio.
Let me just
Gandy.
Take a look here. Antonio Gandy Golden.
Golden.
Yeah. So I talked to both Tracy Hackler and Chris Carlin this week. And it looks like we'll be back in the swing of things next week, including, hopefully, fingers crossed, SP Authentic Hockey. All right. So that's that. Now, earlier this week, I had the opportunity to talk to WWE superstar Mickie James, our two-part interview. The first part, we talk a little bit about wrestling, her thoughts on the whole Divas Revolution and her thoughts on that. And then scheduled to post on the Fans of GoGTS Live Facebook page after the show is the second part of the interview, where she talks about all the other things going on in her life, including a cause that she's deeply devoted to as the ambassador of the child abuse help organization, Child Help, her music career, and her new podcast, Grown Ass Women, which she does with friends of the program, Lisa Marie Veyron, who you may know as Tara or Victoria from WWE, as well as SoCal Val. which can be seen every Wednesday on YouTube. One quick apology to Mickie. The last couple minutes of the recording, for whatever reason, got corrupted and it cuts off pretty abruptly, so I apologize for that. So for anybody who doesn't want to wait till tomorrow when the full video is posted on GoGTS.net, that will be available on Fans of Go GTS Live Facebook page.
I was just going to say, so what I'm hearing from you is I need to go search Fans of Go GTS Live and request membership to that private Facebook
Correct.
Group.
Correct.
ASAP.
Correct. But
because you can still listen to the interview here.
The first part, yeah.
While doing
that. Absolutely. So we'll turn it over to the one and only Mickie James. Well, I am super excited to be joined by current WWE superstar.
Thank you.
Anxiously awaiting the return to the ring.
Right. Yes.
Well, I know you've been really busy since, you know, this whole pause in the action with your injury and rehab, and anxious to get back to the squared circle. And want to hear about all the stuff you've been doing in the meantime. But before we dive into that, really curious to get your take on someone whose career has spanned kind of both sides of the fences. Wanted to get your thoughts on going from the Divas Revolution to the WWE's conscious decision to retire that moniker and transition to the women's division and superstar status.
I think that was like a very unique thing because prior to the Divas, we were superstars. We were classified as superstars.
Right.
We were already classified. Like, we were superstars. We just had our own names. We didn't get classified under this umbrella of, oh, this is the Divas. We were Mickie James. We were Lita. We were Trish. We were Molly Holly. We weren't part of a collection of people. We were ourselves. We were superstars. And then it wasn't until, it was almost like when that whole diva thing happened to where I was like, I don't know how big, like, I get it as far as a marketability thing of like to be able to push to the young female fans of like, oh, they want to be a diva or they want to be this, to like encompass us all in like this collection of girls. But the problem with that is that if one person of our collection does one thing wrong, it represents all of us rather than if I, as Mickie James, do something wrong, Mickie James, the superstar, then suffers the consequences. Mickie James, the superstar, then it's on her, not on the collection of the divas. So that was like my only thing that where I was like, I don't really love this divas idea, but you know, because I also think in my own mind, I go like, I've worked for so long and for so hard to build up the name of Mickie James, to make Mickie James the superstar, not to make, you know, a collection of girls who I don't have a relationship with outside of when I walk this into this locker room. And then when I leave this locker room, to elevate them, to make them superstars off of the hard work I've done to build my name on my own. So it was like this weird dichotomy, I think, that happened when that whole shift happened as far as naming the girls the divas, and people have mixed emotions on it. And I feel like although it did open up a lot of doors for the women, it was a very debilitating thing. It almost like took us backwards in a
sense. Exactly.
It took us backwards because we had made so much progress already. And I think people, you know, kind of, you know, we as a culture have, you know, we like to remember what we like to remember and how we like to remember it. And it always isn't the way it's the reality, right? Like, we would like to rewrite our truth in order to be able to put it in the way that we want to remember it. But in reality, I felt like all these women before us had made such strides to get to this level. And now these women, the Litas and the Trishes and all this, they were household names. And I was so blessed to come in to be able to become a household name as Mickie James, you know what I mean? And I think that if the divas then became the household name instead of the individual, you know? So that was like a thing. So then to have to like go back then after we had worked so hard to do all that work to get to that level, and then divas happens, right? Which is however you feel about it. Some think it's wonderful. Some think it was horrible. I kind of play both sides of it because I benefited from it, but I also saw the parallels to it, right? But then you have to go back and redo all that work that we already did to then bring up to where we can have now a female that is a groundbreaking kind of outside of the box star that then makes a name off of her own name or the man or a moniker or whatever. Right. Right? You know what I mean? So
absolutely. Absolutely. Do you think it's easier for women to enter into WWE now than it ever was?
Yeah, absolutely. I think so. I think the path is much easier. It's much more laid out than it was 15, 20 years ago. I think this was a very man's world. This was a man's business. You know, you had to be a very thick-skinned female in order to survive, whatever role that was, to survive in this male-dominated sport. They were working two shows, traveling towns or whatever. The, you know, stuff that, like, you know, our mentality is just not meant for. And then you put on the fact of being a female and an emotional female, or however you want to look at it. It's just like, you have to have very thick skin in order to make it in any type of industry, whether you want to be the CEO of a company, whether you want to be the top actor, actress in Hollywood, whether you want to be the biggest NFL superstar that the world has ever seen. You have to have thick skin, because people are going to tell you no, and you're not good enough, and you'll never make it, way more that they're going to tell you that you're great. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
There's going to be very few people that are going to tell you that you're great. So you just have to learn to, like, use that, you know, and I think that that is one of those things that I'm very grateful for in my own, you know what I mean? Of being told no so much and being growing up in a male dominated. I love the way that I came in because it gives me a different perception. You know what I mean? Because I wasn't handed anything. I had to train with all guys because no girls were really training to be wrestlers. They were training to be valets or managers or whatever, but there wasn't a whole lot of women that were training to be wrestlers. And so when I say it wasn't harder to get, I had God knows how many tryouts, probably 50, 100 tryouts before I even got a job.
Wow.
You know, like, it was a lot. It was a lot that I would just drive to Florida from Virginia, drive to wherever so I could be backstage at Raw and SmackDown tapings and, you know, hopefully get a tryout match. And the tryouts were way different than they are now, where we actually got into the ring and Fit would get into the ring with us and we would work out with the other girls and actually get a chance. Now it's like, well, because of, you know, legalities and if somebody gets hurt or something like that, I feel so bad for a lot of these independent guys that come up to the show and they're expecting this one thing and they literally have to kind of just sit in the stands, which is interesting. You know, it's a learning experience and it's whatever, but at the same time, it's not the same as when I was trying to try out of like actually having an opportunity to get into the ring in front of some of the producers, in front of some of the talent that someone, the right person, not everyone's going to get you, but the right person might get you and see you and think that there's something special there. And it's like, even though you get the opportunity to come up there and try out, you really don't get the opportunity to showcase what you can or can't do.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Good
so
point.
It's a different dichotomy. It's really unique. And so it's like, how, this is how like so many of the same people keep coming back for the same tryouts because they don't get a real look, you know? And it's tough. It's harder now, I think, as a whole, because thankfully there's other companies. So there's not just the one. Like for a while, it really was just the one and that was it. Right. So now there is the opportunity. That's the beauty is this, now that you don't have to go to the main stage in order to make money, to make a healthy living for yourself and to be okay. Like you can make good money and not go to the big dance. There's several platforms for you to do that. But it depends on what your goals are. You know, if you just want to make money in the business, sure, you can do that. But if you want to be a superstar, you kind of have to, you need to make it to that next level. And I think that there's a lot more opportunities for women and that they've stopped looking at women and giving them this like kind of a backhanded compliment of, oh, that was a good match for the girls. Like the girls really put on a good match right today. Like,
right.
What? So I'm sorry, ladies. And I say this with utmost respect and love because there is a massive difference than going out there and having a really great match and memorizing what you said. You guys were all going to talk about the back room, background in the back room.
Yeah.
And going out there and performing that, executing that without any hiccups. That is not a good match. No. That's the difference. And I feel like our perception of what and our allowances, because we've done so much of that, of like, okay, as long as I can like memorize like A through Z and get through this without any hiccups, no screw ups, no nothing. We had an awesome match. No, you didn't, because you didn't listen to one time to what one person was or was not reacting to out there. You just went out there and performed like a circus clown. That is not having a good match. And that, from the fans' perspective and from the talent's perspective, is where that line has been blurred. And that line has been that people will go out there and say, oh, that person is a really great worker. No, they're not. They're not a great worker. They're a great wrestler. Yes. Doesn't mean that they are a great worker.
A lot more to it.
There's so much more levels. Just because you can go out there and do a shooting star 360 press off into the thing does not make you a great wrestler. That makes you a good acrobat. That makes you, or a good worker, I should say. That makes you a good acrobat. That makes you a talented performer. Does not make you a good worker. And I would never discredit anyone's talent. However, there is an art form to going out there and knowing what you could and couldn't do in those situations and having those in your back pocket. But there is an art form to not memorizing and feeling and listening.
You made an interesting comment about the designation of, you know, putting the preface of women's match and not just match. And
right.
I have a 12 and 14 year old daughter. And I remember one time watching, and my 14 year old said, "Hey, Dad, how come they never say that was a good men's match?"
Right.
Can you imagine being able to pick up on that at such a young age and the influence and impact that that has? And that's why going back to women superstars, I think, has been such a great thing to see. And there's still some room to do, you know, things to work on in WWE. But from an equality standpoint, I don't think it's ever been more so.
Well, yeah. And you say that, and it's like, because that is a learned thought process and that is a learned behavior. And we still, even now, like when you say like, you don't hear like saying, "Oh, that was a really great match for a guy's match." You would... I'm sorry. Like, I remember getting some of this, "Hey, you guys really, for a girls match, I'm just impressed." And I'm like, thanks.
Thank you.
Question mark. Because for me, I'm like, I want to go out there and have a great match. I want to show you up. I want to come back to the locker room and say, "Hey boys, follow that." I love that. I love that feeling, because I feel in my thing that we are the same. We are on the same level. I travel the same road as you. I take as many, if not, I've probably taken way more bumps than you.
Probably.
Way more. I travel the same. I deserve to get a massage at the end of the show without a side eye, because I've paid my dues. I've put up my rings. I've broken them down. I've driven to the next town. I've done all those things, plus some. Plus stuff, because I grew up in the business when it was way different. Some stuff that you guys wouldn't even imagine doing. I've carried bags and with a smile on my face, because I wanted to earn the respect of my peers. I didn't make excuses. I didn't say, "Oh, you guys are being harder on me because I'm a woman," or because, you know, I never made excuses. I took it and I did it with a smile on my face, and I may have bitched in my hotel room. And at that point, like at those times, let's say, face it, I wasn't in my hotel room by myself. I was probably had three or four other girls or my friends in there that we were all split in the room five ways going like, "Can you believe this guy?"
Never. So what's a better compliment? You're a great wrestler or you're a great worker?
I say, I don't, from the boys, from the locker room, you're a hell of a worker. You know what I mean? From a fan, it's really hard. I don't expect, in fact, I'm grateful that not all the fans are the ones that are sitting there going like, "Hey, Mickie, you're a really great worker. I really loved your match way back in Ring of Honor, this person." I don't love that. Like, I love that a dedication. I love that. But it takes that, the fun, the fun for me as the character out of it. Like, I love that they are that passionate and they love me as a performer and as a worker, and they respect the business that much to have delved themselves that much into it, to know that much about it. But as a whole, a normal average wrestling fan is not going to tell me I'm a great worker because they don't know what that is. And I don't want them to know what that is. I don't expect them, and I don't want them to know what that means. I want them to think that either I'm a terrible human being if I'm a heel, I want them to really like loathe me, or I want them to really, you know, adore me and respect me. Obviously, you want respect as wholeheartedly in this business. But from a real wrestling fan, like just like a fan of wrestling, watching the show, I want them to feel about me what I'm trying to make them feel about me. And that doesn't mean like me going out there and being a heel on TV and then trying to sell my merch on Instagram. That is not being a heel. That is not. It's not like, and I know the difference, there's a massive difference in the business and the world. And obviously we pulled the wool back ages ago, but there is an escapism to it. You know what I mean? It's an escapism to it. And there's an art form to it. And I go to the movies and I don't sit there and question how they did that special effect that blew up that, or if that was even real. And how did they computer generate that thing? Because that looks great. I don't do that. I just allow myself to get lost.
To be entertained.
To be entertained. Exactly. Right. Right.
Well, you know, you are so much more than a wrestler. So let's talk a little bit about that. I mean, you've currently got a ton of projects going on, including the brand new debut of your podcast, Grown Ass Women, G-A-W for short. Tell us about that.
You know, we've all been sitting here in quarantine. And, you know, this everything and something that like Lisa and I and Val and I, we'd all talked to separately about doing something fun to really like embrace our female audience. And I feel like that's something that we really don't do. We say we do. We put out T-shirts. We have catchy phrases and we say we do like empowering things for the women's. But as a whole, we don't really go after our female audience. Like our fan base is driven mostly by men. You know what I mean? So sure. I felt like it was really important that we, especially because we've come so far in the business, to do something, to create something and cultivate something that is specifically, you know, designed for our, you know, more feminine audience and stuff that they want to talk about, whether it's fashion and food and all these, it's mostly outside stuff, outside of the world. Like we have wrestling guests and we talk about wrestling and it comes in the conversation because that's obviously where we know each other from. But we talk about so much more and we talk about like real life and it's all in lighthearted talk, you know, like I remember being asked if I could or would do a podcast when they first like were a thing. And I was just like, oh man, that means I have to watch all the wrestling products.
Oh.
Be aware of everybody's stuff. I'm like, I cannot keep up. Like, I want to keep up with my stuff. I want to keep up with wherever I'm at and the people that I care about. I want to be able to watch their stuff, but I cannot process 12 hours of wrestling on a weekly basis. I cannot do it. I don't care how much I love it.
So who made it happen? Obviously, you guys had some conversations, but what?
We did. And we had, you know, the term grown-ass woman gets thrown around. It's a very American, I don't know if it's an American phrase or it's a whatever. But it's something that I have heard thrown around. Like, I'm a grown-ass. Like, you get into a thing and be like, oh, no, he did not talk to me like that. He better know I'm a grown-ass woman. I will come down there. So that's kind of how it, and then it started, like, as I'm sitting there and then Fox and I traveled a lot together, Victoria Fox, and we had talked about doing a grown ass woman. Like, we were going to try to get it on television of like, we're team gaw, team grown ass women. We don't take the shit. We don't take any crap. Like we've been there, done that, got a t-shirt and a shot glass and a keychain. Like we already know, we've played as Gabs before, grown ass babies trying to be a grown woman. And if that is over, like we are grown women and like we help pave the way. So you're welcome. Like it was one of those type of attitude kind of things. But it just never come to fruition. Like it just never, like we tried to get it over in our own right, but they were not biting on it. Maybe because it said ass. I don't really know. I thought, I was like, well, we can say, you know, astonishing. astonishing.
There you go.
You know, oh, there's a plethora of alpha. There's an immense amount of A words that we could use. But it doesn't matter. It's like, because now when I look back, because we had written like the laws of God, of like the book of God, how to be a God, how to get to build your God pyre, all these like really. And then, so then we're all, you know, talking about it. And I'd written it in like this notebook and stuff like that. And obviously we talked about it here or there. And as then we're sitting here for the Corona, the COVID, this massive, like, we've been sitting at home a whole lot.
Yeah, right.
A lot. So I was like, oh, maybe we do have time. And Val has such a vivacious personality. Lisa's hilarious. But Val's very, because she does a lot of stuff with Fight TV and all those different networks. And she's very, she's an amazing host. Like an amazing host, but she does a lot of the editing and stuff as well. And just, I think the three of our personalities just mesh and bounce off each other so well. And it's just, it's easy to watch. It's especially as a lighthearted content to not be so serious in your face. Take us seriously. Hey, let's just laugh together. Let's laugh about how we embarrass ourselves, how we, the things that we do, the things that we don't do, what you like, what empowers us as grown-ass women to help, you know what I mean? And just to provide a different type of outlet, just to laugh. Like, it's more just, if you need a good laugh.
Where can people watch or listen?
It's on YouTube. It's great. On YouTube. So, and I think it's a God TV show, because we just got our URL. You know, you cool. have to wait for the whole month. So we thought we were going to be able to get God TV, but we got God TV show. But obviously, you can go to godtv.com and everything's there, from our Instagram, our Twitters. You can go on either myself, Lisa, Marie, Tara, however you know her, Victoria, her social media accounts, or Val, SoCal Val, and you will find, we share it in our story, so you will be able to find it. But YouTube is, you know, you subscribe to the channel, you hit the little bell, you like the videos. Please like the videos. it helps us out so much if you actually like and subscribe. But it's really cool, and it's just fun to do. You know, we release one every, we kind of tape in advance so we have content, you know, because all three of our schedules are so different. But so we're a little bit ahead, but we put out every Wednesday, and then we actually go live in the chat rooms while the episode is airing. So Lisa, Val, and I are in the chat room.
Oh, that's awesome.
Commuting. That's awesome. Yeah, conversating with everyone who's there joining us live as the show premieres. And then obviously you can always go back and watch it and comment. It's very fun. Cool. We love it. We love being able to do this and be able to provide and do something fun for our fans.
So very cool, very fun. Thank you to Mickie James for doing that. And like I said, part two will be available at 11 p.m. Eastern time on the Fans of Go GTS Live private group. But I made joining super easy. If you already like the Go GTS Live Facebook page, when you apply to join the group, it'll be automatic and you can watch the second part. The complete unedited interview about 42 minutes in length, including what you just saw, will be posted along with details about her new podcast on the GoGTS.net blog tomorrow. In addition, Mickie said she is sending an 8x10 photo for us, autograph photo for us to give away. And so what the blog post will have is a Gleam campaign attached to it that you can enter to win the autographed photo right on the blog post. So look for that to be published sometime tomorrow.
So you're telling me that we don't just give away stuff on the show.
Uh-huh.
We're giving away stuff all week long.
Yeah, basically.
Nice. So.
Yeah, thanks to an article Kelsey Schroyer did on Super Break monthly subscription boxes, I just sent out three cards to one lucky winner last week. So, yeah, we try to give away stuff on the blog, too.
Nice. So pretty simple. Make sure that not only do you watch the show on Thursdays, but when you're jonesing for hobby content during the week, aside from just Twitter, there's some great websites out there. You know, we've mentioned Sports Collectors Daily during our hobby happenings. Well, we've also got exclusive blogs and content from great writers on GoGTS.net. along with giveaways. Rob, I know we've got a cooking show, but I actually also just want to ask you, because I know you're a huge wrestling fan, what was that interview like for you?
Oh, it was super enjoyable. Mickie's good people. Knowing that she's doing her podcast with someone that I know really well, and Lisa Marie Veyron, I felt instantly at ease in talking to Mickie because we had some commonality, which was fun. And she was just super gracious with her time. And as you can tell in that interview, she's just the real deal. She's down to earth. So it was a lot of fun. Thanks, Ivan. All right, let's update the poll question because, wow, 390 of you have voted in. And have you or do you plan to purchase any Topps Project 2020 cards? Yes, starting to make some separation, 58.7% to 41.3% saying no. And you still have about 17 minutes left to vote in the poll if you haven't already.
Not to mention you've got about 17 weeks still to get swept up in Project 2020. So, Rob, we're going to revisit this as the weeks go by and see if your answer hasn't subtly changed at some point.
All right. Well, let's dive into a look at new product releases that are hitting hobby shelves, online retailers, and group breakers next week, and our weekly segment, Hot in the Shop. And we kick things off with the much-anticipated 2019-20 Panini National Treasures football card, or excuse me, basketball cards. NBA basketball from Panini America National Treasures. First off the line, sold today, and hobby debuts next week with 8 autograph or memorabilia cards, plus 1 base or parallel card, and 1 printing plate in every box. The most sought-after rookie patch autographs of the NBA season arrive with the release of National Treasures, which has become its staple. Look for RPAs of all the top rookies you've been following, Zion Williamson, Ja Morant, RJ Barrett, Rui Hachimura, and many more. Look for the incredible Logo Man autographs, treasured tag autographs, and one-of-a-kind items from players like Charles Barkley, Steph Curry, Shaquille O'Neal, and many more. Collect the incredibly unique personalized autographs of superstar talents and chase history in the NBA Finals nameplate set, which features full-letter nameplate patches. Also look for pieces from the Toronto Raptors' first-ever NBA Finals victory. The complete checklist is up and available now on GoGTS.net.
Well, Rob, baseball collectors are not left out this week either. We've got an exciting high-end collector dream returning this week. 2020 Topps Diamond Icons baseball cards, where each box is going to deliver 7 autographed cards signed on card, along with 2 autographed relic cards signed on card, and 1 relic card in every box. And here's one where even just the relic cards are giant, chunky, exciting items. So look at some of these great-looking, high-end autographs. There's going to be Diamond Icon autographs numbered to 25 or less. 1 silver ink in every case. 1 silver ink autograph in every case. Of course, look for relic autographs with giant pieces of game-used memorabilia. Look for single-player, dual-team autographed relic gold parallels. Kind of an exciting twist on the dual patch card, showing stuff from 2 different teams. There's also the autographed jumbo patch card, which has become very popular with high-end collectors. There's some immortal cut signatures numbered 1 of 1, as well as traditional cut signatures numbered to 4. There are, of course, the Diamond Icons jumbo relics with autographs right on the relic. How cool is that? And again, some of the material in here, from bats to jerseys. In the past, we've seen batting gloves, spikes, the logo patches, 1 of 1 MLB silhouetted batter logo patches. Another exciting thing to chase. Oh, and as the name suggests, there's diamonds. That's right. Diamond cards on their own or diamond autographed relic books. This product's going to be hot this week in the shop.
And another diamond-themed baseball card product releasing this week. This one is Panini Diamond Kings baseball cards. For those of you unable to shell out at the diamond icons, this is something that might be up your alley, but it's still going to deliver an autograph card and a memorabilia card in every box, along with three framed parallels and 12 inserts. Find the first autographed memorabilia cards of the 2020 rookie class in DK Material Signatures. Legendary memorabilia has long been a calling card of Diamond Icons, so be on the lookout for DK Materials, Jersey Kings, Bat Kings, and Diamond Cuts. Look for DK DeLong and DK T206 cards throughout Diamond King, whose design was inspired, obviously, by those past iconic sets. There's multiple combinations of memorabilia and autograph cards, as well as autographs of retired veteran and prospect players with four different parallels numbered to 99 or less found in the DK Signatures autograph set. Some fun inserts, including the 3000 Club, All-Time Diamond Kings, DK DeLong, and much more when this hits stores next week.
Hey, Rob, we previewed a 16 autograph box of Sage football cards earlier on this show. Well, coming up this week, we have Sage Aspire football cards, which is going to deliver 24 autographed cards in every box. And the other really cool thing, we've said it many times with Sage, but because of the fact that they're a smaller company, they pay attention to make sure that there are multiple first round skill position player autographs in every box. It's guaranteed. You're going to get at least one first-round quarterback, one first-round wide receiver, and one first-round defender, as well as an additional first-round pick in every box. There are multiple tiers of base autographs going all the way to one of ones. There's etched foil on every single card, along with colored parallel versions. And there is the randomly inserted Aspire to Greatness Drew Brees Joe Burrow dual on-card autographed card, along with parallels. I think we need to get, who's the founder of Sage again, Rob?
Tim Guideman and Chris Stratton.
Yeah, I think we need to get Chris on the phone, or Tom, if either of them will do it, to talk about how do you put together a product like this with this many on-card autographs in the middle of what we've all been going through. That said, check out 2020 Sage Aspire football cards this week. 24 autographs.
Not bad, huh? Yeah. One of the most, I think, beautiful draft-related football products on the calendar year in and year out since its inception has been Leaf Flash football cards. And this year promises to be no different. 2020 Leaf Flash football is going to deliver five autograph cards in every box, featuring a star-studded cast of elite prospects from the 2020 NFL Draft with a heavy emphasis on skill position players. Extremely limited production run. Look for all the top names from the draft, including Tua, Joe Burrow, Jalen Hurts, Chase Young, and many, many more. Great themed autograph insert sets, including Flash Photography and Flash of Brilliance, which really do just absolutely pop when you have them in your hand. A vast selection of colored prismatic parallels also accompany the set when it hits stores next week.
And Rob, we've got an exciting buyback product. If you're a football fan looking for some classic players in some classic jerseys, beautiful on-card autographs, well, 2020 Super Break Football number 12 and 15 edition delivers 1 to 2 premium buyback cards in every box. Now you might be wondering, well, what happened to number 13, 14? I don't remember number 11. Well, Rob, if you pay strong attention, you know that number 12 is Tom Brady and number 15 is Patrick Mahomes. Those are the drivers in this product, with some incredible hits available from each of them, including rookie cards, on-card autographs, what looks like National Treasures autographs, Panini Contenders rookie ticket Patrick Mahomes autographs, along with a slew of other NFL stars that you can get in this. So again, each 10 box case is guaranteed to contain a minimum of one number 12 and one number 15 buyback hit. Group break spots will be less than $50 a spot, with all teams represented in this product. So you can do a standard 32-team random group break. So again, top modern rookies, current superstars, Hall of Famers, silver prisms and refractors, along with one-of-ones, RPAs, superfractor, one-of-one autographs, some jumbo patches, logo shields, and much, much more. Oh, is that a cut autograph of Tom Brady that I see? Yeah. That's right, debut of the Bar Superfoil Cut Auto and Memorabilia One-of-Ones, which are redemptions also, so there's no way to pack search for those. But the redemptions are limited only to the best of football greats. So, very exciting case coming out from Superbreak. Check that out with your favorite breaker or your nearest hobby shop.
And last but not least, 2020 TriStar Hidden Treasures autographed 8x10 football photos. Excuse me, it's a mouthful. One autographed photo in every security sealed envelope, including a wide selection of Hall of Famers, current NFL stars, top rookies, fan favorites, and many more. There are, for you case purchasers, 15 autos in a case, case guarantees, 6 Hall of Famers, 5 place and history players, 2 current stars, and 2 fan favorites. All autographs authenticated by either TriStar, PSA, DNA, JSA, or BAS. Current and former players include Jim Brown, Joe Montana, Brett Favre, Tony Romo, Tom Brady, Joe Burrow, Kyler Murray, Travis Kelce, and many, many more. And look for randomly inserted gridiron tickets redeemable for signed memorabilia from players like Jerry Rice, Joe Montana, Emmitt Smith, Marcus Allen, Tom Brady, and many more. This will be in stores and online next week. Enjoy and be sure to tag us with all of your big hits with hashtag GoGTSPC to be featured in our outro video. All right, our last segment of the evening, we want you to meet Joshua Devaney, an Australian collector who owns the largest collection of Michael Jordan toys and figures in the world. And he wants to give it all away. Well, sort of. Watch this, and we'll be back to announce tonight's winners.
Jordan toys. In the last 5 or so years, I've been... I believe I've spent just over $100,000. My name's Joshua Devaney from Perth, Western Australia, and I obviously have a huge passion for Michael Jordan toys. The majority of them I have collected are his action figures, but his toy range really started with basketball hoops. There's a basketball hoop you can see in the background just here. I had that hoop originally back in 1994. It was one of the very few Michael Jordan toys that made it to Australia. And I was just searching eBay one night and I stumbled across it. I purchased it off eBay, remembering all those great times that I had with that hoop, and that snowballed into what we have here today. So I purchased off eBay a figurine one day, a Michael Jordan figurine. It was in a clear plastic bag. I was really baffled as to why it wasn't packaged properly. I found a couple more on eBay and I kept buying those. And again, they kept arriving in clear plastic bags. The people responsible for making this toy, which was his very first toy from 1987, was Ohio Art. I contacted Ohio Art to find out why these were in plastic bags, and they got back to me and basically said that these were a pre-production prototype figurine which was never meant to be released, or it was basically meant to be destroyed. There was only 48 of these available, and I was in possession of 33 of them at the time, which was quite amazing to have discovered something unique to Michael Jordan, and obviously something so rare. It's the only toy he's ever been photographed with in 33 years, and yet it never happened.
See how the toy's got that red collar up around the heel at the top, and then it's got the Nike tick as well. So they've used a Nike shoe on a Jordan product. So I think Nike have intervened and said, we're not going to allow you to use our shoe on your toy because we're not getting any kickback from it.
I really would love to get this over to America permanently. I would love to have this displayed in Chicago or somewhere in America of some place of significance to MJ, where they can just go and be surrounded and learn about these toys and hopefully hands-on touch them. And I would like to donate it to Michael. So I'm certainly not even out trying to make a dollar off it. I would just like to give this to Michael as part of his legacy for people to enjoy it, fans and stuff like that.
Pretty cool, huh? Yeah, I thought so too when I saw it, so I wanted to share it with you guys.
I mean, I just wish I had that many. But how do you not play with them?
All right, Ivan, you got some winners?
I do. I've got 16 winners to be exact, although one of them already knows and probably already claimed her prize because she's just that good. But if you're one of the 15 remaining, first off, thank you for watching. Thanks for hanging out with us this Thursday night. As we said at the top of the show, it's all about the hobby, and the hobby's all about the people. So thank you for keeping us here and fun and enjoying this hobby together. That said, if you hear your Twitter handle called, you have to be watching to win, because you have to claim your prize from hearing your Twitter handle called. Otherwise, the prize goes back into the prize pool for next week. Doesn't happen often, but it does from time to time. So if you hear your name called, there's an email address right at the bottom of the screen, gogtslive@gogts.net. You need to send us an email with your name, your mailing address, your Twitter handle, and what you won. Make it easy for us to line you up with our columns here on our spreadsheet, and you will get your prize before you can say, is it too early for flapjacks? Or something like that. Rob's pretty quick with the shipping, so big shout out to Rob. Thank you to Rob and his family for giving him the time to ship. And without further ado, let's go ahead and announce some winners. So first off, with Cryptozoic, who's got the incredible Cryptozoic Con happening next week, June 11th and 12th, we have two exclusive Outlander sets to give away. The first winner, Melanie Pauls, congratulations. The second winner is at MistyMan27. Congratulations at MistyMan27. You are the second winner of the Outlander 3-card exclusive set that will ship to you after Cryptozoic Con. Remember that. Don't be mad. Next up from our box preview of Panini Select Baseball. First off, we've got that big, chunky Bobby Bradley patch. That's going to Marky Moran. Congratulations, Marky Moran. The Adbert Alzale patch autograph is going to Thing 22517725. If you're Thing 22517725, please do not claim that prize. It is Thing 22517725. Congratulations, Thing. Next up, the Tony Gonsolin patch. I just said it already. Goes to Jason Rocco. That's an easier one there. Thank you for a clear Twitter handle. The Tony Gonsolin patch to Jason Rocco. And then the Yu Chang auto patch number to 25 goes to Camo Logan. Congratulations, Camo Logan. All right, now from Sage Hit, we've got the Joe Burrow inserts, the little Joe Burrow collection going to Ian Ilmatic. Congratulations. The next one, the DJ Dallas inserts. It's not a huge hit, but he'll love it. NJ Sensation. Congratulations, Justin, NJ Sensation. Viewer since season one. Love to see it. And then the 4 on-card autographs will be randomed along with some extra autographs. Those winners are, winner number one is JULAUS06, JULAUS06, Card Call 720-74015. These numbers, man. Card call 720-74015. Number three is going to Justin Levy.
My chips?
There's a naked kid in my room trying to grab some chips, so sorry I'm covering up the screen. Justin Levy 04, you're the third winner of the Sage Hit Autos. And then James 0424 is the fourth winner. So did everybody get that despite the slight interruption there? Awesome. Next up for contenders. So first off, we have a list of or a lot of sort of parallels, inserts and parallels. That's going to Go St. Louis Blues. Congratulations, Go St. Louis Blues. And then our three contenders autograph bundle winners are the Matt Peak, Browns Fan 221, and Rasner Sarah. Congratulations, all of you winners. And if you didn't win tonight, don't worry, you're still a winner in my book because you're my friend and you hung out with us and you interacted in the chat and you gave us hearts on Periscope and we love you.
Yes, so special thanks to Mickie James for taking time out of her schedule. Her publicist, Megan Potter, and let's see, Chris Stratton at Sage, Tracy Hackler at Panini for providing plenty of boxes for us to break. To James Gale behind the scene. Ivan Lovegren, as always. One quick note, though. We are off next week. My wife has to have surgery, so I'm going to be busy. If you could keep her in your thoughts and prayers, nothing life-threatening, but she's got a long recovery ahead of her. So I'll be taking care of that, but we'll be back the week after that. So what is that? 4-11, the 18th. We'll be back with a brand new episode of Go GTS Live, the Hobbies web show. So for James Gale behind the scenes, Ivan Lovegren, and the entire GTS team, listen, have a great weekend. Remember, it's a hobby, and always be collecting, but just make it fun. All right? We'll be back in a couple of weeks. Thanks, everybody, and have a great weekend. Bye-bye.
Bye for now.